What got you interested in philosophy?
What got me into philosophy is actually I got into politics. So when I was a high school student, I got into political activism. I did a lot of sort of demonstrating and protesting against the war, which was new at the time, and getting into the politics of globalization. So by the time I got to college and I started looking for classes that I felt like might be more in line with the stuff that I was passionate about, my political activism, my social justice stances and things like that. And after trying out a few majors that were boring and a waste of my time, I signed up for a philosophy class. I signed up for a class on feminism and philosophy. And that class really struck a chord with me. I started to realize that, like, this is how I think, and I didn't realize how I think could be a class.
So what are the most important subjects that you think you'd have to cover for your class?
What I think are the most important subjects, my colleagues at other schools don't necessarily agree, and we meet occasionally and talk about this, and I know they run their classes differently. So I think it's most important to teach the basics, and then to move very quickly into the kind of subjects that are meaningful and matter to my students' lives. So I always have to kind of adjust on the fly. So I can tell you what I intend to teach, but if I have a group of students who obviously doesn't care about something I've scheduled, then we won't do it. We'll do something else. We'll make an adjustment.
What are the least important subjects in philosophy?
Analytic philosophy is, in my opinion, is just dreadful. And I had professors, you know, Bill DeVries is somebody that I mentioned to you before. He's passionate, but loves analytic philosophy, and I can't stay awake for it, because I feel like it doesn't have anything to do with living a meaningful life. So analytic philosophy is really hard for me. Logic is a part of that, and I think logic is something that's really good to understand, and you can really build good arguments if you understand the rules of logic, but studying logic as its own field is really kind of dry.
Who are the most important philosophers that you think should always be covered?
The most important philosophers, in my opinion, are the ones who were clear about their ideas, which is why I throw out somebody like Hegel, and the people who really get us to take life seriously and to question what we think we know.
Do you think there's a lot of philosophers that have been left out?
Yeah, women. Women. I think if you study academic philosophy like I did, and you take class after class, and you learn about basically what all these men through history wrote, incredibly intelligent men, most of them had women in their lives that were challenging their ideas. Some of them had women who were writing, and their efforts weren't respected. You know, these sort of old-fashioned kind of patriarchal cultures didn't really want to take women's ideas seriously. So somebody like Descartes, for instance, you know, he wrote these books and he wrote these meditations, and he's like really well known today for all of his wonderful ideas. But what a lot of people don't realize is for years of his life, he was corresponding with the women in his life in letters that we have now. And the women were the ones that were challenging him on his ideas. And he would then go back and rework them and try to be able to respond to what these women were saying. And then he'd publish the books and kind of get all the credit.
Based on your criteria, what would make someone a philosopher?
Well, it's not a university professor. We'll put it that way. I think that's how the word is used today, a professional philosopher. I don't think philosophy is an occupation. I think a lot of people walking around are philosophers and they don't wear the title and they don't care about the title. So a philosopher is somebody who values thinking and using reason and weighing out evidence. And I would even go one step further in saying somebody who's pursuing truth, and when they think they've found it, is willing, has the courage to live their life accordingly. I think a lot of people don't take that second step. They publish papers and then they live differently. And I think, you know, a real philosopher is somebody who kind of follows Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, and actually puts this stuff into practice and tries to live better.
Do you think there's not enough attention paid to philosophy?
I don't know how much attention philosophy deserves. So I think people ask themselves philosophical questions all the time. So taking like a class in philosophy could be helpful then, because you can kind of learn how to think about the questions that you're already thinking of. So I think, you know, for instance, like American schools, we don't tend to think that philosophy is worthy of being studied. And I don't think parents think it's a worthwhile use of their children's time. I know my parents didn't, which was a fun conversation to have when I became a philosophy major. And I don't know why that is. I think there's this stigma out there that that isn't fair, that if you study philosophy, then you're not going to specialize in anything that you can make a good financial living off of, and then you've kind of like doomed your future.
Do you think there will be an increase of people getting into philosophy in the next couple of years?
I don't know what makes a philosopher. I think that's a philosophical question. I don't know that I have that one settled. I mean, just thinking about people who decide to study college academic philosophy and then go into the field, I don't really see that changing. If anything, it might shrink just because the number of jobs for professorships are shrinking up. But I think it's not just that. I mean, it's that you still have those attitudes and that stigma out there that a lot of people think that philosophy is a waste of time and it's sort of like a one-way street to poverty. I mean, the jokes are funny, but there's jokes all over the place about philosophy. You know, like what's the difference between a philosopher and a large pizza, right? A large pizza can feed a family of four. Like, I think jokes like that are really funny, but they're actually misguided. I'm trying to remember which magazine it is. It might be Forbes. If it's not Forbes, it's one of those kinds of magazines. Every year, they publish a list of median income by major. And philosophy degrees are almost always in the top 10. And I think if we get to a point as a community, as a culture, where we realize that the skills you learn in philosophy are useful and important, such as clear, articulate thinking, forming an argument, learning how to break down a text and analyze and synthesize ideas. Those are all things that we value. If we realize that those are things that are a part of philosophy, they're just completely intertwined with everything there, then I think more parents will encourage their kids to take philosophy classes, and that could lead to an uptick. But I don't see any evidence that that's going to happen. I just think it probably should.